Good morning. If you would please turn your Bibles to Jonah chapter 1, we'll be in verses 10 through 16 today. As many of you know, I have a lot of siblings now, especially. I have eight or seven, something like that. I can't always remember it. But I have a lot now, and three of my siblings, my brothers Cole, Easton, and Titus, we would have to do chores a lot. We were required to do them after school every day. We had to feed the dogs, feed the cows, make sure that they were all watered and ready to go every single day. One day, though, in particular, it was just Cole and I that were doing the chores. We were feeding the cows, or supposed to feed the cows. And our dad told us that day that if the chores were not done before he got home, we would be in a lot of trouble, right? And that's understandable thing to happen. And Cole and I, apparently that day, we were being extra stubborn because we decided that we would wait till about 4:45 to actually get started on the chores. And our dad gets home around 5, sometimes even earlier than that. And we thought we could get it all done in time. And we head out there. And of course, our mom was telling us, you need to get it done now. We were actively disobeying her in the moment there after school. And our dad gets home while we're in the middle of feeding the cows. We have like a half a bale left to feed to them, and we would have been almost done, but he got home, saw his car come in, and he yells at us, and he said, I told you that the chores were to be done before I got home. And he sent us to our room. And sure enough, well, we knew what we did wrong, and sure enough, we ended up getting a spanking for that. Maybe 2 or 3, I don't remember exactly. I like to block that part out of my memory. But we were punished for what we did. We were supposed to have the chores done before we got home, and we didn't have them done, and we were punished for it. We were actively disobeying our Father, you know. But in the same way, we are all sinners. We are all sinners, and we are always actively disobeying our God and Father in heaven. Is there anything that we struggle with today that is sinful? Is there anything that we struggle to obey God with? Is there anything in our lives that keep us from obeying God, that hinder us from obeying God? If you struggle with this in obeying God, then join me as we explore God's character and what he has done for us to help us in these struggles. Please join me in reading Jonah chapter 1, verses 10 through 16. Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, "What is this that you have done?" For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. They said to him, "What shall we do that the sea may quiet down for us?" For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. And he said to them, "Pick me up and hurl me into the sea, then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to get back to dry land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more tempestuous against them. Therefore they called out to the Lord, "O Lord, let us not perish for this man's life. And lay not on us innocent blood for you. O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked up Jonah and hurled him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and they offered sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. Please join with me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time that we are able to be here, Lord, to dive into your word, to explore what you have for us today. I pray, Lord, that the words would fill this room, that you would speak to us through this passage, Lord. I pray that your Holy Spirit would work in the hearts of everyone here, that we would all be open to what you have to say. And I pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. So what do we learn about God in this passage? We will learn about three truths about God that are evident in the passage. The first truth is that God punishes disobedience. The first truth is that God punishes disobedience. We actually see this directly in verse 10, which says, "Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, 'What is this that you have done?' For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them." First of all, they are exceedingly afraid. They are terrified. Obviously, they are afraid because of the storm that's surrounding them. They're afraid because they're caught in the storm that's threatening to destroy their ship, that is so strong, something they've never seen before. They're terrified. They're extremely afraid. But that's not the only reason. In verse 10, Jonah at this point has told them everything that he's done. He's told them that, hey, I am a prophet of the living God. But I ran away from him. I disobeyed this God, and now he's punishing me for it. That is the reason why they are terrified. They see a prophet who has disobeyed this God and is punishing them. They are afraid that this God is going to destroy them too because of him. These are pagan worshipers. They're religious. They understand the aspect of the gods and a prophet. They understand that if a prophet disobeyed the gods in their religions, then that would be a dangerous thing to do. It would be wrong. They would understand that it is sinful. They would understand the danger that Jonah has brought upon them. And so they tell him, "What is this that you have done?" And in other words, it's not necessarily a question that they're saying, but it's really what they're trying to say here is that what you have done is wrong. You are foolish to have done this. Why on earth would you do something like this? It doesn't make sense. It's dangerous. And now we're going to suffer for it. They see what is going on around them, and they see that this God that Jonah worships is the living God. And they realize that God is punishing Jonah for his disobedience. And perhaps they aren't just fearful about this specifically, but also fearful that God is going to punish them for their sinful actions. Maybe they realize at that moment that they are sinful too, and God's going to destroy them as well. However, it's likely that they are really just terrified that Jonah has led his punishment to them, that it will lead to their deaths. And they are also upset with Jonah to have done this to them. We see here that Jonah recognizes that God is punishing him for his disobedience. And that much more, the sailors, although pagan, also recognize it too. We can see here that the first truth about God in this passage is that God punishes disobedience. He's actively punishing Jonah for what he's done. The second truth is that God requires obedience. We see this in verses 11 through 14. In verses 11 through 12, it says, "Then they said to him, 'What shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us?' For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. He said to them, 'Pick me up and hurl me into the sea, then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you.'" Immediately the sailors are asking Jonah, "What must we do to calm the storm? What do we need to do to you specifically?" This response is implying that they understand that God is requiring obedience of them and of Jonah. They are ready to do anything they can to save themselves from this raging storm, to hope that God will calm the storm for them. They are ready to obey what God has for them. So Jonah tells them, "What you must do is to throw me overboard. Throw me overboard, send me to my death, and I will die, and the storm will be calm," right? At this point, you would think that they are just confused. Imagine yourself being in this kind of a situation, right? Imagine yourself being in the middle of a hurricane. You're out on the beach and a hurricane hits and you're all by yourself, and then suddenly some random person that you have no idea who they are comes to you and says, "Don't worry, got this under control. Just go ahead and kill me, and this will all be over." You would be puzzled. You'd be confused. You would think this person is absolutely crazy. They're foolish. What in the world is wrong with them? You would have no intentions of killing that person. You would be afraid to kill them because you would know that killing someone was wrong. You wouldn't want to do that. It wouldn't make any sense to. This is exactly what the sailors would have been feeling like. They would have been confused. They would have thought he was crazy to say something like this. But this is what Jonah told them to do. He's a prophet of God. He knows what God's told him to do. So they should do it. But they decide not to. And this puzzling confusion leads them to make a decision that we see in verse 13. Saying, "Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to get back to dry land. But they could not, for the sea grew more and more tempestuous against them." The men rowed hard to get back to dry land. This doesn't seem to be a bad thing. This seems to be a perfectly normal thing. They're avoiding killing someone, and they're just trying to get back to safety. There shouldn't be anything wrong with it. But Jonah, or whoever the author may have been, uses the word for the Hebrew word chatar in this passage to indicate to row, that the men rowed hard to get back to dry land. The verb chatar. Normally, when this verb is used, it means to dig. So essentially, you get this idea of digging into the water, the idea of rowing. However, this verb is only used 7 times in the Old Testament. And 6 other times it's translated to dig, except for this time it's translated to row. Every time that this verb is used, it has a negative connotation to it. It usually has the idea of digging under a house or digging into the temple to steal. It has something to do with burglary of some kind. There's a negative connotation to it. This idea that they are actively disobeying God. And so Jonah could have used any other verb that means to row, but he uses chatar, which means to dig, with a negative connotation to it, which seems to suggest that Jonah is trying to tell us here that they are directly defying God by rowing to dry land, by avoiding throwing him overboard. They are directly disobeying something that God told them to do. It is an act of disobedience. It is not just they were rowing, but as the intention behind it was disobeying God. The sailors disobeyed what Jonah told them to do, and the sea continued to grow worse. God punishes them even more because of that. They finally recognize that they really must obey what Jonah told them, because it must, in fact, be from God. We see then in verse 14, "Therefore they called out to the Lord, 'O Lord, let us not perish for this man's life. And lay not on us innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you.'" The sailors at this point are pleading for God's mercy. They recognize that if Jonah is innocent and we throw him overboard as you want us to do, don't hold it against us. Don't hold it against us. We don't want to kill someone who is innocent. But they know that this is what God requires of them. They understand that God requires obedience from them. And so they fully submit at this point to obey God's command to throw Jonah overboard. And they recognize this when they say, "For you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. For you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." Sometimes, even for Christians today, God will tell us or have us do something that we aren't really thinking is what we are supposed to do. But as Christians, we are able to have an understanding of what God's will is for our lives. That when something does happen, we can pray about it and understand what God's will is for us. And sometimes it might seem crazy, it might not seem normal, but we are required to obey God's will. Tell that to my parents when they have a family of seven, and then suddenly they are told that there's three kids that need to be fostered, right? To take in three children. This might seem crazy, our family's big already. What are we supposed to do? And my parents make that choice because they believe that it was the will of God in that moment, and they obeyed God and took in those kids. And now we can see the reward that we have for obeying what God has told them to do. We are commanded to obey God, just as Jonah and the sailors were. So far, we see that the first truth is that God punishes disobedience. And the second truth is that God requires obedience, which leads us to the third truth, that God rewards obedience. That God rewards obedience. In verse 15, so they picked up Jonah and hurled him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. The sailors finally submit to what God has told them to do, to carry out what Jonah told them to do, in hopes that God will answer their prayers to calm the storm in front of them. So they pick up Jonah, they take him to the edge of the boat, and they hurl him into the sea. And immediately the storm is calmed. It disappears as if nothing ever happened. God rewarded them for their obedience. It is like the idea of a child obeying their parents, and their parents reward their children in hopes that they would continue to obey them. God rewarded the sailors for obeying his command to throw Jonah overboard. And we see this continuance of obedience in verse 16, where it says, then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. This is probably not something that happened while they're still on the ship, but probably something that happened once they were off the ship. It doesn't make sense that they would be burning sacrifices on a wooden boat. It doesn't make any sense. This is probably an act of worship that happened after they're on dry land and realize what has happened to them and realize that this God is in control of the sea and we are going to worship him. We are going to make vows of continual obedience to him. This idea that we want to worship him and obey him continually because we have seen what he has done to the sea. We fear this God because he is strong and powerful. But we also saw the reward of a calm storm because we obeyed him. We also see from other passages of scripture that God rewards obedience. In Psalm 19:11, where the psalmist is speaking of God's commands, saying, in keeping these, there is great reward. God rewards obedience, whether in this life or in the life to come. They obeyed God and were rewarded for their obedience, and then continued to make vows to God as a vow to obey him from then on. We have seen that the first truth in this passage is that God punishes disobedience. That the second truth is that God requires obedience. And then finally, the third truth is that God rewards obedience. I mentioned Psalm 19:11. In keeping these, there is great reward. It is easy to say that we would probably want this great reward. We want this great reward. And this great reward that I'm referring to is heaven, eternal life, after this life that we live today. We see that God punishes disobedience. We all have been disobedient, though. And therefore, we must be punished. We see that God requires obedience But we all fail to meet that requirement. We see that God rewards obedience, but if the reward is heaven and we deserve punishment, what hope is there for us? What hope do we have in ever receiving this kind of reward? But there is hope, and that hope is in Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. He was sent to this earth, and he was perfectly obedient so that we would not have to be. He took on the punishment for us so that we would not have to. And by believing in him, in Jesus Christ, we can have that eternal life. We can have that great reward in heaven if we only believe that he died and rose again to save us. How can we apply these truths of God and the work of Christ in our lives today? The first application that I have is to worship God, that we must worship God. God is a just God. He is a holy God, and he hates sin. It might seem unfair that to us that maybe we do more good than we sin. Our good outweighs our bad, right? That's fair. We should be able to get to heaven because of that. But that's not possible, because God is perfect and holy, and whatever he brings to heaven must be perfect. These truths here show us that we must worship God. It should lead us to worship God. The sailors worshiped this God, this just and holy God. I would much rather worship a God that hates sin, it would not let sin come to the gates of heaven, than worship a God who could care less about the sin coming before his presence. I want to worship a God who wants what is good and pure. I want to worship a God who will destroy evil. The sailors feared this God, and they worshiped him because he is just and holy, and because he hates sin. In the same way, we must also worship God, the Lord of heaven and earth, for who he is and what he will do. We must also worship God for what he has done on the cross, for sending his son, Jesus Christ, to die on that cross so he could save us, that we can be saved and have eternal life in heaven with him. And worship Christ, our Lord and Savior, for his willingness to die for us so that we could have that eternal life, because he was obedient even to the point of death. There are so many passages, so many reasons to worship God from what we learned in this passage today. But how do we worship God? We worship God in every aspect of our lives. We worship God by being obedient in truth, by showing him that we want to obey him, by worshiping him with our voices, whether it is in preaching and singing, teaching, or in prayer. We worship God with every aspect of our lives, whether at work, to work for him, to glorify his name, to do everything for the glory of God. That is how we worship God. That is what we must do. We must worship this great and powerful, holy God. The second application is that we must be obedient. That we must be obedient. Being obedient is probably one of the hardest things for any of us to actually accomplish. Especially when you add the stipulation, you must not grumble and complain about it. We see this in Philippians chapter 2, verse 14. Paul says, do everything, do all things without grumbling or complaining or grumbling or disputing, to do all things in this way. When we're asked to do something, we may not verbally complain and grumble about it, but we may not want to do it. Even in our thoughts, if we decide that we really wish we were not doing this and grumble, complain about it in our thoughts, we are still not being obedient. Just because we are doing the action that we were told to do does not mean obedience is there. Because we are grumbling and complaining. If we also look to Philippians chapter 2, verse 8, we see that Paul associates obedience with being humble. He says, "And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." This implies that one cannot be obedient unless they are first humble, understanding that they are not above God in any way. The moment one grumbles and complains, they are no longer being humble before God and are sinning against him. So being obedient before God means to be humble before him as well. The opposite of grumbling and complaining while trying to be obedient is to be joyful when we are obeying God. To be joyful, we should have the attitude of being joyful to obey this wonderful, perfect God. We see this type of phrasing in Psalm 119, this idea that I love your laws and I long to obey your commands. This is the attitude that all Christians should have when we are obeying God, to be joyful and humble before him. And this should lead us to pray and meditate on these words, to pray to God and say, God, help me to be obedient, to be perfectly obedient, to be joyful when I do obey you, God, and to be humble before you, and to pray upon Psalm 119, to read those words and meditate upon them and realize that this is how we must be when we obey God. This should be designed to encourage us to be obedient to whatever God's will puts in front of us, but also to be obedient in places where we are not. Being obedient means to obey God's commands for our lives that are written in Scripture. And what better way to show how to be obedient than by exploring the greatest commandment? We see in Matthew 22, 37 through 38, that to love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and that this is the greatest commandment of all. The commandment that we should all long to obey. We are to love God with our full self, to be fully devoted to him, living in worship and prayer. But most of all, to be involved in God's word, because God's word has everything to do with being fully devoted to him. God's word is written on our hearts in Psalm 119:11. God's word is involved in the sanctification of our souls through the work of the Holy Spirit, which means we are growing in Christ, becoming more like him. And we cannot do this if we do not have his word to show us what that looks like. And we can only grow if we desire to grow in the knowledge of Scripture, to love God with all of our minds. We are commanded in Scripture to study the word of God, to love God with our minds, meaning we should be ready to give a defense for our hope in 1 Peter 3:15. To teach and train others in righteousness in 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17. But how can we do that if we do not read and study the Word of God on our own? The Catholic Church was a very strong body early in its years. It was so powerful, it became the ruling government at the time. And it made rules for the teachers and the people in the church. The teachers were the only ones allowed to study and preach the word of God. And the people were not allowed to read it. They were not allowed to set eyes on Scripture and study it for themselves. Otherwise, they'd risk being thrown into jail. The people were not able to study God's word, and that was a problem. But the church has changed. The church allows the people in the church to fully understand Scripture, to fully dive themselves into Scripture, to study it fully as much as they can. They allow them to do that. They have the opportunity to do that. The only problem now is that the people in the church, although being able to study Scripture, want the teachers to study it for them. This is a really big issue, I think, in the church today. We are seeing that the younger generations are falling away from the faith quickly because they don't know their Bibles. We see that 70% of all youth that grow up in the Christian household reject the faith by their freshman year of college. 70%. Because they don't have the knowledge of Scripture that they should desperately have. They don't have the knowledge to be able to defend the hope that they should have in Christ. They do not have the ability to love God with all of their minds because they do not know their Bibles. That is why it is so important for families to teach their kids the Word of God. For you parents to fully devote yourselves to God and seek to love God with all of you by deeply involving yourself in the Word. And in turn, teaching your children to do the same. Those of you who are teachers in the church, continue to teach God's Word. Continue to be teachers in the church, to continue to want to help others grow in their knowledge, to be able to love God with all of their mind. Continue to be teachers of God's Word. And those of you who are not in that kind of situation, you're not a teacher, and may not be a parent, I urge you to grow in your knowledge of Scripture by studying it on your own each day, to study it fully, to fully devote yourself to Christ, to love God with all of your mind, but also to join groups outside of the church or outside of Sunday to fully involve yourself in Christ and in God's Word so that you may be ready in season and out of season to use the Word of God to defend the hope that you hold so dear. When we devote our lives to God by studying His Word, we will see all of the things that He has commanded us to do. We will, in turn, have the desire to joyfully and humbly obey His will. This is what God wants in our lives, to live obedient and worshipful lives for His ultimate glory. We have seen that God is holy and a just God who punishes disobedience, who requires obedience, and who rewards obedience. And through Christ, our Savior, by dying on the cross and rising again, we are free from eternal punishment and given this great reward of eternal life in heaven if we believe that Jesus Christ died and rose again for our sins, that He is the Savior of the world. And that will in turn lead us to worship Him and to fully devote ourselves to obeying what He has told us to do. Please join with me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank You for Your message today, Lord. I thank You, Lord, for teaching us who You are, that You are a holy and just God, that You do not allow sin to come to Your presence. But You have made a way for us. We praise You, Lord, for giving us Your Son, Jesus Christ, to give us a way to have that eternal reward in heaven if we only believe in what He has done for us. I pray, Lord, that You would use this to help us to continue to worship You, Lord, fully, and to obey You, and to obey Your will and the commands that You have for us in Scripture, to obey all of it joyfully and humbly. And I pray, Lord, and ask these things in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. Amen.